Jesus, 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 what a wonder you are. Jesus, 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 what a wonder you are. Jesus, 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 what a wonder you are. Oh, Jesus, what a wonder you are.
All over this building, I say the name of Jesus. Sing Jesus, Jesus, Jesus,
Jesus,
what a wonder you are.
Wonder you are.
Sing Jesus,
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus,
what a wonder you are.
Wonder you are.
Whoa. The beautiful rose of Sharon, sing beautiful,
beautiful rose of Sharon.
What a wonder you are. Beautiful rose of Sharon.
What a wonder you are.
Beautiful rose of
Sharon.
What a wonder you are.
Stand to your feet. We're just going to receive the word of the Lord from an anointed vessel, as you know, our assistant pastor, Sister Melva Meredith Lewis. Sister Melva, if you would come, God bless you. Just reach your hand toward her and pray for her. God bless Sister Melva. Let's receive the word of the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Why don't you clap your hands one more time to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's worthy of the praise. Now clap your hands unto the Lord like you really want to worship Him. Amen. He's a good God. He's a faithful God. Hallelujah. He deserves all the praise. Thank you, Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. I greet you in no other name but the name of Jesus. Amen. The name given among men whereby we must be saved. Praise God. Demons tremble at that name. Amen. And we can find solace in Jesus. Amen. Praise God. Thank God for his presence. It's good to be in the house of the Lord on this day. Praise God. It was a struggle getting to this point, but God is faithful. Amen. God is faithful. So we're going to turn to the word of the Lord. We're in the book of Psalms, Psalm 119, and we'll read the first 18 verses. And it reads, "Blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with the whole heart. They also do no iniquity. They walk in his ways. You have commanded us to keep your precepts diligently. Oh, that my ways were directed to keep your statutes. Then I would not be ashamed when I look into all your commandments. I will praise you with uprightness of heart when I learn your righteous judgments. I will keep your statutes. Oh, do not forsake me utterly. How can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to your word. With my whole heart I have sought you. Oh, let me not wander from your commandments. Your word I have hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against you. Blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your statutes. With my lips I have declared all the judgments of your mouth. I have rejoiced in the way of your testimonies, as much as in all riches. I will meditate on your precepts and contemplate your ways. I will delight myself in your statutes. I will not forget your word. Deal bountifully with your servant, that I may live and keep your word. Open my eyes that I may see wondrous things from your law. Open my eyes that I may see wondrous things from your law." And the message title today is, "We Have His Word on It." And if a sermon in a sentence is, "The word of God is the key source to live by and therefore must be our daily bread." The word of God is the key source to live by and therefore must be our daily bread. Amen. Pastor has already prayed and accepted in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. You may be seated. So Publishers Weekly revealed the top selling print books in 2019. Number one on their list was a book called Where the Crawdads Sing, which sold 907,000 copies in 2019 and more than 1.1 million since it came out. Second was Michelle Obama's book, Becoming. It was the best-selling book in 2018. This year, it sold 888,611 copies so far. And so the first six of this list of best-selling books, we have This Where the Crawdads Sing, Becoming. Number three was a book called Dog Man. Number four, Girl, Stop Apologizing. Number five, The Diary of an Awesome Friendly Kid. And number six, Girl, Wash Your Face. Now, why are these books with these titles on the bestsellers list? Simply put, according to Tucker Max on entrepreneur.com, every bestseller list is a lie because no bestseller list measures the best-selling books. No bestseller list measures the actual best-selling books. So every bestseller list either measures a limited number of sales in a few places, or far worse, it's the curated list and a small group of people that are deciding what to put on their list. And they're picking books based on what they think are important books, not based on what is actually selling. The most important bestseller list is the New York Times bestseller list. They readily admit that their list is only reflective of books that are selling at a certain number of bookstores and online retailers around the country, but not an actual bestseller list. See, they must admit this publicly because they were sued about it. So whether it is the best-selling books or book that sold the most in 2018 or 2019, the Bible is not among them. And I am very glad that they did not recognize it with other books. Those are just books. The Bible is the book of all times. It is the best-selling book in a class all by itself. So Brandon Gale, Small Business and Marketing Advice, said, they put an article out in 2017, and it says 20 million, that's the number of Bibles that are sold each year in the United States alone. The Gideon International distributed over 59,460,000 Bibles worldwide in 2017. In 2018, they did over 80 million books, Bibles. That's more than 100 Bibles per minute. The percentage of Americans who own at least one Bible, whether it was given to them or they purchased it, is 92%. Two-thirds of the owners, regardless of religious affiliation, say that the Bible holds the meaning of life. The average American Christian owns 9 Bibles and wants to purchase more. Anybody in that category? And so for this reason, the Bible is actually excluded from the bestsellers list because it would always be on top. So why are so many people interested in owning a Bible? So I asked some folks over the weekend at random, just random people, why do you read the Bible? And I got the following just one-liner answers. For spiritual strength and guidance, it is my mirror. Somebody says, got to believe in something that can keep me strong. Give me clarity and food for thought on the decisions I make. Somebody else says, gives me connection to the past and reminds me why I am part of humanity. For connection to the past, present, and future. For guidance, different perspective, for things I'm going through. It gives me insight, guidance, for answers to the adventure of life. To find out more about life, one person says. To be with God, another says, making that connection because nobody loves me like God does. To build a relationship with the Father, for inner peace, for hope and solace, relatability to my life, for self-empowerment, somebody else says, to worship God and pay my respect to him, another says. Someone says, as a person, I need boundaries, so reading the Bible gives me that. It keeps me in order. To provide salvation and peace, it offers guidance. One person says, it's my GPS to understanding who I am and what God wants me to be. It's like daily food. Reflects my values. So it's one way of introducing me to God. And then somebody else says, it is filling, satisfying. And that's only 23 people at random, 23 individuals that I asked. So let me ask you the question, why is the Bible important to you? Think about it. Why is the Bible important to you? Now, with 1 minute on the clock, I want you to find two people in the 1 minute and tell them why the Bible is important to you, starting right now. Amen. So we have people who own Bibles, for some more than one. We have people who read the Bibles and those who say that the Bible is important to them, and some of those people also read the Bible. And if the Bible is that important, why don't we read it consistently? If it is that important to you, why aren't you reading it consistently? Someone said that it takes 70 hours and 40 minutes to read the Bible through at pulpit rate. Not at Brother Chris's pulpit rate, but at pulpit rate, right? And aloud. It takes 52 hours and 20 minutes to read the Old Testament and just 18 hours and 20 minutes to read the New Testament. The longest book, Psalms, will take just 4 hours and 28 minutes. Almost half the books in the Bible take less than half an hour to read. 23 of them can be read in less than 20 minutes at pulpit rate. Not a long time. Even if you double those times, it is doable. So why aren't we doing it? So while you may know how many books are in the Bible and the number of chapters and verses, or even the middle chapter in the Bible, when you open the Bible, you are looking for more than just that. You are looking for more than just reading it at pulpit rate. You want to find answers to your questions and discover the contents of the Word of God and its meaning to your life. The Bible is the written Word of God, and in it, God uses the language of man to reveal himself and build a covenant relationship with mankind. In Genesis, the book of beginnings, the Bible reveals God as creator and the one who gives life. It introduces you to the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and leads you into some interesting family drama, family connections and interactions, while all the time pointing you to the God of the universe. In Exodus, God saves Israel from slavery in Egypt and then enters into a special relationship with them. In Leviticus, God gives Israel instructions for how to worship him. In Numbers, the Israelites failed to trust and obey God, and so they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. And in Deuteronomy, Moses gives Israel instructions, in some ways a recap of the laws given in Exodus and Numbers for how to obey God in the promised land. That's just the first five books authored by Moses in a line. But when you read the Bible, Brother Gus, your understanding opens, God opens your understanding and reveals himself to you. The way he may reveal himself to Sister Velma might be different, but each of you get something, even if it's the same chapter or verse that you read. God will speak into your spirit things that are necessary for your life. In reading the Bible, you will discover what you need to believe, who you need to believe, and what you need to do about what you believe. The Bible is the greatest book available to mankind. There is a presence of unity in the Bible because it is the inspired word of God. The Bible claims such inspiration. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, it says, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work." It tells of men speaking as they were moved by the Holy Spirit in 2 Peter chapter 1. Inspired words of God. I mean, the Bible contains 66 books written over a 1,600-year span. It's over a period of 40 generations by approximately 40 authors from every walk of life. For example, Moses, we consider him a political leader trained in Egypt. Peter, a fisherman. Amos, a herdsman. Joshua, a military general. Nehemiah, a cupbearer to the king. Daniel, a prime minister in Babylon. Luke, a physician. Solomon, a king. Matthew, a tax collector. Paul, a tent maker. In different places, Moses in the wilderness, Jeremiah wrote in the dungeon, Daniel on a hillside and in the palace, Paul inside prison walls, Luke while traveling, John in exile on the Isle of Patmos, others all over the place. They wrote at different times, David in times of war and Solomon in times of peace. They wrote during different moods, some writing from the heights of joy and others from the depths of sorrow and despair. They wrote on three different continents, Asia, Africa, and Europe, in three different languages, Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek, which subject matter includes hundreds of controversial insights, the origin of man and the universe, the nature of God, the nature of sin and man's redemption. Yet there is a harmony, unity, and continuity in the Bible. The reason for the unity, men were inspired by God to write what we call the Bible. It is available to each of us. It's available on your phones, on your computers, on your tablets, and is open on many night tables, on many beds, if I could say so, yet a closed book to so many hearts. The Bible says, "I will be blessed if I walk in the law of the Lord." In order to know what the law says, I must open the Bible and read it. My life depends on the Word of God. The Bible is not just a book that we need to read to find answers to our problems. There are hidden treasures for everyday living. The Bible teaches you, for example, how to be relational, how to use money, how to live in your marriage union, how to treat each other, how to be healthy, how to treat your parents, how to treat your children, and about God's redemptive plan for mankind, among other things. Everyone wants to share what they feel or think in books or messages, but God's thoughts are way more important, and therefore we need to read it. Many of us are so health conscious that we make sure we exercise and we strengthen our muscles and we eat our vegetables and take our multivitamins. And some of us are so alert about our body that we know when something is wrong. We know when our body feels a certain way, and we may say, you know what, I perhaps need some iron, I'm feeling weak, or I need some probiotics, my stomach doesn't feel too right, or I need some vitamin D, I'm too sleepy. We know our body. Our souls should be no less, therefore. We should detect the hunger pangs we feel spiritually and the thirst in our souls for the Word of God. See, the written Word of God should penetrate the very essence of our soul and lay it open. The Bible does not have all the answers. No, it does not. God designed it that way. You cannot open the Bible and say, turn to page 85, for example, and find a recipe for cooking pastas. Or turn to Jeremiah and find how to change the oil in your car. Or the book of Esther, chapter 2, verse 7, in knowing how to do an updo hairstyle. You will not find it there. There are some things you will not find in the Bible, but the teachings of the Bible are designed to lead us into covenant relationship with God. It provides principles to live by. You will not find the principles on relationship, for example, in one chapter. You will need to search the scriptures. The Bible speaks about precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little. The principles of the written Word of God is to help us to live soberly, godly in this world and to lead us to the one who created us. Amen? Everything we need, we can find in God and His written Word, which leads us to Him. Therefore, the Word of God is the key source that we need to live by. You and I need the Bible. We can trust the Bible. God is trustworthy, and therefore His Word is also trustworthy. Reading the Bible lets you understand more about God, what we have in Christ, who we are in Christ, and why we are in Christ. It is filled with promises for you to discover. It is the key that unlocks many doors in our lives. See, life can be challenging. Everywhere you go, there is a challenge. Everywhere you work, there is a challenge. We live in a society that has conflicting views and ideas. So whether you are at home, school, work, life can be very challenging as you sort through relationship issues, political views, and endless options and opportunities in this world. Life can be overwhelming. However, the Word of God, you can find answers in the Word of God for the challenges that you face from day to day. You can find peace in your despair and comfort in times of sorrows and promises when your beliefs are challenged and correction and instruction when you struggle to find your way to God. Psalm 119 verse 4 to 6 says, "You have commanded us to keep your precepts diligently. Oh, that my ways were directed to keep your statutes. Then I would not be ashamed when I look into all your commandments." The Word of God, in it you can find assurance in uncertain situations. When life was uncertain, Abraham trusted God. His faith did not waver. We can choose to believe God just like Abraham did. See, the number one book on the bestsellers list cannot strengthen you spiritually when you are weak and faint-hearted. But Psalm 46 verse 1 can, because it says that God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. So we sometimes want to give up on the things we do for God, but Paul is that example in the written word of God that shares how he was shipwrecked and imprisoned and beaten. Paul held on regardless of what he faced, and so can we. Because the psalmist says in Psalm 34 verse 19, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. So many of the challenges that we face in life, we have God's word on it. We can find it in God's word. Amen? Anybody here have a challenge? We can find it in God's word. Amen. I'm going to ask the media team to put up that first question. Amen. Now you're going to read the question as you see it displayed on the screen. And I'll give you the scripture verse. Amen? So let's read that together. Read Psalm 23. Next one. Psalm 34, verse 18. Psalm 37, verse 25 to 26, or Matthew 6, verse 25 to 34. Psalm 56, verse 11. Psalm 130, verse 5. Matthew 6, verse 14 to 15. Matthew 11, verse 28 to 30. Luke 1, verse 37. Do you know where scripture that is? Hebrews 11. Next one. Luke 15, verse 11 to 32. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 9 to 11. James 1, verse 13 to 15. And 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13.
Do you doubt God's love?
John 3, verse 16. And what does it say? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. See, the Bible is our instruction manual. It is our spiritual roadmap. It is our compass that will lead us to eternal life, and we cannot live without it. So let us open the Bible consistently and read it, meditate on it, research it, talk about it, write about it, WhatsApp it, text it to your friends, engage with the Word of God, eat it. It is food for your soul, amen? And it will prevent spiritual malnourishment. In Psalm 119, David refers to the word of the Lord as commandments and precepts and statutes and testimonies and laws and the word. See, that chapter tells us about the excellent power of the word of God. So whether you call it the Bible or the Holy Scriptures or the law, the holy book, the scroll, the sacred book, book of truths, the canon, the oracles of God are the word of God. It does not matter. You just need to wrap yourself around this book and read it. Amen. Ezekiel chapter 3 verse 4, he says, it was like in his mouth like honey in sweetness. But David in Psalm 19 verse 10 says it's sweeter than honey. So we need to consume it. See, the Bible is not something you read if you have time. It is the book to read, so make the time to read it. It is the best-selling book ever. It is the best book to read. The Bible is the number one favorite literature to read. It is a must read. It is a must have. So you need to read it. Joshua chapter 1 verse 8, the Lord said to Joshua, "This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success." Do you need success in your life? Folks, open the Word of God and begin to read. Begin to meditate on the Word of God, and it will change your life. Let's clap our hands unto the Lord. You cannot have access to what you have no knowledge of. And you cannot conquer if you don't know how. The Bible is God's infallible word. It is not a book of information, but it is a book of revelation and transformation for each of your lives. Proverbs 30 verse 5, it says, "Every word of God is pure. He is a shield to those who put their trust in him." So the word of God is authoritative. No wonder Isaiah says in Isaiah 1 verse 2, "Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord has spoken." See, God is the final authority. Therefore, when he speaks, everyone must listen. Psalm 138 verse 2, "I will worship towards your holy temple and praise your name for your loving kindness and your truth. For you have magnified your word above your name." That is how important his word is. He puts it above his name. See, the word of God is effective. In Hebrews 4, verse 12, it tells you, "For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." We heard the written word and it changed our lives. It is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Now we need to read it consistently to maintain a life that is sold out to God. We need to read the written word consistently because it reveals to us the living word, which is Jesus Christ our Lord. That's why John 1 verse 14 tells us that the word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. See, the written word and the living word are both sources of food for our soul and light to our pathway. The written word leads you to Christ. But the living word says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." See, the written word said that Jesus took 5 loaves and 2 fishes and fed 5,000 men. The living word, Jesus declares, "I am the bread of life." See, the written word tells you that Lazarus was dead, but the living word declares, "I am the resurrection and the life." The written word says, "Lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, ye everlasting doors." But the living word declares, "I am the door." The written word says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." But the living word says, "I am the good shepherd." The written word says, "The people who sat in darkness had seen a great light." But Jesus came, the living word, and he says, "I am the light of the world." He is worthy to be praised. So as you discover more about the living word in the written word, it will draw you closer to him. So your ultimate aim should be when we make contact with the written word, we should simultaneously make contact with the living word, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Why don't we clap our hands and give him praise one more time? When you read the written word, the Logos, it will give you a rhema word, which is the Holy Spirit just speaking to you, giving you a word to encourage you on your journey, to enlighten you, to strengthen you, sometimes rebuke you and chastise you, but other times encouraging, directing, and comforting you and giving you an assurance for your day. It is that important, saints, to read the word. Your eternal destiny depends on your obedience to the written word and your acceptance and faith in the living word. Amen? Now, you might be here today and you haven't even given this word a thought. Maybe you haven't accepted Christ as your Savior, but the word says that it is not his will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. His word says that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. His word tells us that he loved us so much that he gave his life for you. His word tells us that we need to repent of our sins and to be baptized in Jesus' name, and he will fill you with the gift of his Holy Spirit. You need the written word, and you need the living word in your life. So if you don't have him today, I want to introduce him to you. Praise God. You can have him today. We have water to baptize you, Brother Owen. There's water. We still have water back here. Hallelujah. Anybody who is thirsty for God, amen, he's here to fill you and to satisfy your soul. Praise God. We need to be connected to the word. We have to command our day. Take control of your busy life. You have to find time for the word. You have to find a space to read the word. You have to share what you read maybe with a friend for accountability purpose so that you become consistent in reading the word. You need to be a part perhaps of a Bible study group that will help you to read the word effectively. You always want to read the Bible in the same spot, right? Be consistent in what you do. Avoid distractions. Apply it to your life. Just read it. Just read it. Let's stand. Now, some of you may have a Bible reading plan that you use. Some of you may be saying, well, I don't know where to start, and I'll just say, just start at the beginning. Just start at the beginning. Some of you may, in the morning, just do this. You just open it, and wherever it opens to you, read. But you need to read it. And so, whether you have a plan or not, you may have a plan in mind. But whether you have a plan, I want you to think of how you are going to start. I mean, this is the first day of the week. And if you haven't started yet, I want you to think about how you're going to go about reading the Word of God. What kind of changes are you going to make so that you read the Word of God? And so I heard yesterday that, you know, people remember 20% of what they say, but 90% of what they do. And so again, this part is going to be interactive. You need to tell one or two persons how you are going to read the Word of God, or share with them how you read it. What do you do that is effective in reading the Word of God? So everybody has that in their head? Before Pastor comes up, you were going to take a few minutes to do that, because we need everybody being involved in reading the Scriptures. So find at least two persons and tell them how maybe you have an effective way of reading the Scriptures. Everybody, find somebody, perhaps not in your family, tell somebody else how you read the Scriptures or what you're going to do to read it and to be more effective. In Jesus' name. And then I'm going to ask the praise team just to come after they have shared their thoughts. Come on, everybody, move. Find somebody and tell them what you're going to do this week to change the way you read, or to read more, or encourage somebody on how they read it.
Bread of life, sent down from glory. Many things you were on earth, a holy king, a carpenter. You are the living word and bread of heaven.
Bread of heaven,
sent down from glory.
Sent down from glory.
Many things, yeah.
Many things you were on earth, a holy king, a carpenter. You are the living
bread of heaven.
Bread of heaven.
Send down from glory.
Send down from glory.
Many things.
Many things you were on earth, a holy king, a carpenter.
This was an awesome word from the Lord today. Amen. And I will make sure, Sister Melva just had a little problem with her computer last week and wasn't able to send the notes to the rest of our team. And Brother Bernie said, well, I'm just ready for the surprise, see what God will bring to us. And this was wonderful, but I will make sure that I get the notes from Sister Melva, and we'll get them up on the website so you can go to resources, sermon notes, and you can go over this again, because I just love the part that you can read the written word, but you have got to come in to relationship with the living word. And that is what we're all about. So thank you, Lord. Thank you, Sister Melva. And the written word really means nothing to you until you come in touch with the living word. And we're going to pray before we close our service today that all of us will, number one, get in touch with the written word, and that number two, that will lead us into a relationship with the living word. And for those of you who are our guests today who took time to be with us, we just want to give you a little refreshment before you head back out. I hope things have improved during the time that we've been here and you'll get home safe and sound. But if you'll go through the back doors, turn right to the end of the hall, I and others of our ministry team would love to greet you and welcome you personally. Thank you for being with us in the house of the Lord today. And God is good. God is good to us. But let's join together in this prayer. If you have not determined the time that you will meet with God every day, we talked about this last week, that this is our place to meet with God as far as a church building. But in your home, you need a place to meet with God. It's funny, you can be at home, but when you go to that spot, as Sister Melvo was saying, there, just the discipline of going to that place that you have set aside for prayer, for meeting with God, it makes a difference. And so, I think we'll ask the praise team to sing this just a couple more times while you think of the time, the place, the duration of time you will spend in the presence of God, and just how you will go about your reading through books of the Bible. That's my preferred way. Others will follow topics that they start to research on what the Bible has to say about love and peace and salvation and all of these things. Whatever your plan may be, just don't do the one that Sister Melva mentioned that some people have. Just sort of open the Bible and whatever happens, happens. That's not the best plan. But let's discipline ourselves. Let's take this time. And probably I enjoyed this because, as you know, this is my hobby horse. I know that we won't stand firm for long if we are not immersed in the Word of God. Beyond that, it can just be the emotion of whatever is happening in the service. The Word of God is our foundation. It is the rock that we stand on. And so let's all lift our voices in prayer at this time as we commit ourselves to the Word of God. Lord, we thank you for your word, which was not just delivered as that written word to us, but you used a servant today to bring it alive to us, even as you yourself came. And when you spoke, it was that word of God in human flesh speaking to us and drawing us into relationship with you. And you felt that it was not sufficient just to send your word through others, through prophets and writers that you chose, holy men of God who you spoke through, but you felt it was necessary to come and live and be the living word. And I pray, Lord God, that even as we take some time here in the next few moments to really determine in ourselves time and place and what we are going to do, I pray that you would help us, that you would draw us, that you would help us to know how important it is for us to spend this time in your presence. God, I pray that each one here will go beyond knowing you through the written word to knowing you as the living word, to come to know you in a personal way. God, I pray that you would open each heart to hear your word with faith, to come, Lord, and lay our lives before you, to give ourselves completely to you. Allow you to fill us with your presence, your power, your spirit, your anointing, all that you are, all that you represent. Lord, I pray that you would come to live inside of us as we meet you in the written word. We bless you today, and we give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, don't run away. You have another couple minutes that you're just going to come to that firm conclusion of what you're doing. The praise team is going to sing twice more, and then we'll have the benediction, and you'll be free to go. Praise team, just a couple times through.
Gentle Redeemer, God with us, the living.